The condition is really crazy condition.
And that shouldn't give away the whole secret to professional winter.
Mateo Iacchino giving Antoine Albola off his body. Here we go. What a finish.
The guy is kind of talking bullshit.
The team's just got to work a little harder.
Welcome to the Windsurfing Podcast, back again for episode 17. And this week, we have the current world slalom champion. We talked to him about breaking in to the top 10 and obviously eventually the top three and why it took him so long and actually other riders. We talk about relationships on tour. We talk about contracts. We talk about the famous crash between him and Tati Frans. Also, no rules. And the current Finn foil slalom discipline we have got going on the PWA World Tour. We talk about how having a baby or being a dad has affected him and lots, lots more. It is, of course, Pierre Mortefon.
Pierre, ça va?
Ça va, ça va. And you?
Yeah, this is about where my French finishes. So maybe some bad words as well.
Yeah, it's already good, huh?
Yeah, well. Maybe it's better than your English when I met you.
For sure.
Yeah.
But it was a long time ago, huh?
Yeah, we have this classic picture. I'm going to try to find it from 2005, I think, in Christchurch. And you were already like, I think you were 17 and you were about the same size as you are now.
Something like this.
And I was like maybe 150 cm and we're on the podium. I think you destroyed us. I think you won like every race with Big and Space Dog.
So, the good old days.
Yeah. I think you're in France, because it's so windy and whatever, like the amount of hours you guys do as kids is insane, no? I read somewhere that you were one of the guys like...
Yeah, I think so. Because when I was kid, like during all the holidays and especially in south of France, like the summer holiday, we were sailing almost every day because you are like 50, 60 kilos. So you just need 12 knots and you fly. So yeah, when I was young, I was sailing a lot, I think, for my age.
Yeah. And it was always like you always, when you started, you had guys around you that were, I don't know, already professional or whatever. Obviously, in south of France, there is quite a few that you fought straight away, like, oh, I want this to be the career.
No, not so much, because where I was living, it was like you just have guys like Pascal Maca, for example, the speed guy, but they were a little bit older. It was not like in Marseille, for example, where you have the Moussimani brothers and all the other professional guys. Me, I was not sailing so much with some other pro, but and I was not thinking that I'm going to be professional one day, but I was just enjoying. And I remember when I was like young and going at school, my parents, they were always pushing for school. If you have a good result there, you can sail this weekend. And so at the end, it was not like it's going to be my job. But then I followed the way. Maybe I think inside it was somewhere in my head because I was keep going from the beginning to now. But it was not written that I'm going to be professional windsurfer.
Yeah.
So, yeah, but I was just enjoying. And.
But it was always racing? Or who are you, like, your idols, your influences, you know?
It was not. At the beginning, it was not so much the racer because I was sailing in my place. It's super windy, so we were sailing 3.7, 4.2. It was more like checking the, and also when you are young, it was checking the freestyle action. And yeah, I remember I had some poster from Ricardo, for example, and from Josh Stone. And yeah, I was a little freestyler, but long time ago.
Yeah.
And then the good point in France, it's like from 12 years old, something like this, you have already like racing competition with the techno. And this was super nice organized. And you had like the local event, the regional event, then you qualified for the national. And this was pretty interesting. And yeah, I was motivated to go for the national and to discover something else.
Yeah. So you were actually doing techno. I didn't know this. You were, yeah. any temptation to go in the Olympic road?
No, but it was at this time in France, it was not the 293, it was the techno 283. So it was not with the Degger. So yeah, we were at the really beginning, we were doing slalom like the first year. Then we switched to racing, but just with the fin. And then they changed it like 7 or 8 years ago, but it was racing on the fin.
Yeah, so it was like same like in Poland. We had a figure eight slalom, and then the best, like the best guy from every category would go to super eight. You know this? You remember the one was in Grisau, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
I think Robbie Swift won in 2000. I was there.
Yeah. You were there?
Yeah.
I think I was not at the event. I was just on my mini lake going for 1 minute.
Yeah, I remember it was, I didn't know how to, I didn't have a harness yet. I was on a 2.5 and just on the hands, and the Tramontana came and was not easy. I think you guys grew up in something quite different than us. But anyway, the scene in France is always strong, and every time we would arrive to a youth contest, you guys would be like a big team and, you know, strong many times, you know, couple French in the top three, and I guess similar to what it is now. And you were always kind of, you know, up there with the guys and very fast and whatever. But we have to say that in youth, it was not like you were dominating, no? Was I don't know.
No.
NS won, or in Formula Jules won, or yeah, a couple of guys, you know? And was it like, I don't know, you were always, because there is some guys, I recently I thought about it when a young guy asked me. And I wonder if it's really important to go there and try to win and whatever, or the more important thing is the big picture, to get better as a windsurfer and really think to be good when you're already on tour, or like, you know.
It's not easy, because I think there is different example, and I was not like going so good when I was young, but I was, like you say, always there, and you learn a lot, you get a lot of experience, and you are ready for going on the big scene, because it's, when you go for the world tour, it's something different, and I think we all get a big slap in the face when we start. But when I was young also, it was not easy. I was trying to deal with the equipment I had. I was going at school. Yeah, my parents, they were really pushing for this. And also there was one point that it changed also on my career, like 10 years ago. It where I was living, it was always windy. So when you go to an event like in Garda, for example, where it was something like 8.4, 8.6, I was not really used to it, and that was a bit different. So, but yeah, like you said, I think I was more in a mood like to get experience, to learn about all this event year after year, and this give you a lot of a lot of experience and a lot of background to move forward. And because, for example, you have also a guy like Kentel. I think he was winning every single race when he was kid, And maybe it was already too much. And yeah, when you arrive to 30, you are a little bit bored or something like this. I don't know. You have different.
Yeah, it's funny.
And there is also a guy who you never see them doing the youth event, and they are going good on the now on tour.
Yeah, it's funny, this whole generation. Like, for I'm like 2 years younger, I think, than you. And like our whole generation, kind of we came up together through all these youth events. And there is guys like you say, like Enes Yılmazer was destroying us, was not even close. And then I don't know, Gabriel Brown was already doing PWA at 15, 16, was already 100 kilos, didn't even bother to come because he would destroy us as well. And then you have guys like Matteo that was there, but I don't even remember him because he was so bad, you know? So I don't know. I was thinking about this recently and I wonder.
So it shows that there is no best way to arrive where we are now. And yeah, for sure, when you are able to start like really early, I think it's better because of the experience. But you also need to keep the passion because it's not always easy, and you need to like what you do when you are 30, 35, and even some maybe older.
48, for example. Anyway. So you do this, and then actually I read, I went on your profile on PWA, and it says your first event was Lecat 2004 Super X.
Yeah, but this was maybe a mistake. I was a little bit too young. And at this time it was, the event was run by Pascal Maca, and yeah, he pushed me to come and tell me, Pierre, you have to try. But I was like 14 or 15. And at this time, the Super X, it was like, I think it was a good racing style. And I wanted to try, but the mark were big and the guy were fast as in slalom. But it was nice to be part of this, but I was scared. I was on the beach for the rabbit start, and you are next to Kevin Pritchard or Matt Pritchard, Kaoli, all those guys, Taboulet, and you say, what I'm doing here?
Yeah.
And then you come back later, and but it was a good discipline, I think.
Yeah, now would be nice, no, to race a little bit in this.
Sure.
Yeah.
It would be really, really nice.
Yeah.
And but like you said before, The French on tour and in windsurfing in general is pretty strong, because we have like a lot of different sea, we have lake, we have wave, we have strong wind, light wind, and also we are not really supported now by the federation, but like all the system from the beginning, I think it's pretty good because you can start competing like from 12 or something like this, and this is good when you want to race and start competition.
Yeah,
because you now on tour you have all the guys like from Julien, Pascal, Cédric, Antoine. They all did this this techno tour at this time, and I think it helps. But I think in Poland you also have something like this, no?
Not so much in the fan board, let's say, more in the, you know, like Olympic.
Yeah, for sure. Us too, it's stronger on the upwind.
Yeah.
Style.
And so at 19, I guess you get on tour like properly, no? 2010, I think was your first like full year. Or 2009.
Yeah, I miss some event because, for example, in 2010, I decided to go for the Defi. So I was not in Asia. And I think first full year was 11.
Yeah.
Something like this. But I start, and I think then the first event I did was 2008 in Costa Brava.
Yeah.
And this event went pretty well for me.
was windy, no? I think like, that one.
It was 6-2, 7-0, something like this. And I had one or two good days of racing, and I finished like 14 or 15. So it was really nice for a first slalom event. Yeah. And yeah, then the year after, I start to go to Turkey. Then I had 1, 2, 3 events, Zilt.
Yeah.
Then 2011, I had my first full year.
Yeah. I calculated wrong, of course, 2010. You were 21, not 19. But yeah, I'm a windsurfer. I don't need to count. So, so good. Yeah. But what I wanted to ask you is, 2010, 16, 2011, 15, 2012, 18, 2013, 12. Why you think it's everybody? Nobody comes. You were, out of the whole generation, for sure one of the fastest guys, if not the fastest, especially in strong wind, medium strong wind, whatever. Why you think it takes so much time for young guys to breakthrough, to actually get some consistency and start racing at a high level? I mean, these are amazing results, no? 16, yeah. 15, you know, when you're 21, 22, whatever. But if you compare to, you know, to where you are now.
Yeah, but I don't know. I think it's our discipline is like this. I don't know how it was like on the 80s, on the 90s, if some young guy arrived and destroy everybody, but I'm not sure it was like this. I think you need to get the experience. You need to understand how the equipment is working, how the race is working. You need to learn to travel, to organize everything. Then I think when the new, like the new generation arrive at this time, all the old generation was pretty solid. Like all the guys, they were 32, 35, coming to 40. So they were like on top of their career. And I think, yeah, like I said before, our discipline is hard, and you need experience. You need to spend time around the mark. It's not easy, and you don't have all the same budget. You don't have the same amount of equipment. You don't have what I have now, for example. So you need to learn. You need to work and to work step by step and manage to, because it's crazy when you check the result like you did. You have I did like 15, 16, 12, 15, 14, then it came to third straight. And I think you have, something is coming like this. And I remember like it was 2013, and I was fighting for top 15, something like this. Then in Turkey, I lead the event until the last day.
I remember.
And I think that was the click, the something happened there, because I was able to go to some winner final and to do this, to do that. But yeah, you need to be so consistent. It's not like a sprint 100 meter, then it's done. You need to race well on Tuesday, then on you have 2 day breaks, but on Friday it's windy again, then Sunday we don't know, we wait until 5 o'clock, and then you go for a last race, then you can lose everything. Or you can come back. So yeah, you need to be strong. And I think also at the beginning, when you start traveling, you look around, you discover things, and you are maybe not really into the competition. You are maybe 50-50, or you are discovering life also.
Yeah, so you need to kind of figure out how to do things. But for you, was it just like, okay, I keep doing it, I keep doing it, I keep doing it, and it will come? Or were you like, okay, in this event, I don't know, or this year my gear was a bit better, but I need to get stronger physically, or this year, I don't know, like you say, like you were leading in Turkey until the last day, and then, you know, you couldn't really hold it. Was it like step like that? I don't know. You took this year, you took a step with the gear. This year, you took a step physically. This year, you took a step mentally, or you just kind of, you know, kept and just patient to see what happens.
I think it's a mix of both, because for sure I had some point that I want to work and I'm gonna be better on this or that, and you learn from the people you met, the designer, with the coach, the physique coach, and from different people, also from the other rider, the other racer. So it's a mix, and you have to, how to call it, you have to prepare all the piece and be able to, yeah, first you have to put all the level high from on the equipment, on the physique, on the racing skill. And then you need to make the good mix, to make the good cook, to be able to be there at the right moment. And I think this is the hardest, because I have no problem to work on my equipment, to spend time on the water, to spend time at the gym, but then it's not easy when you have to mix with all these different aspects. And yeah, still now I'm learning, like every month, every event I'm still learning. So it's a long, long process, I think.
Yeah, sometimes I feel like I felt like this, that I was ready, but it just didn't happen, no? And then you wonder, no? Like,
yeah, and it's not easy. But I think it's there is sports where it's different, and also where maybe the talent is helping you more. But all the top athletes now in every single sport, they work, and I think they wait for the time a little bit, some less than the other. But you need to, yeah, you need to be able to do the mix well.
Yeah. Do you think it's easier now? Because when I arrived on tour, I was scared like hell to go and ask Antoine or Bjorn or Mike Abuzianis or whatever, you know. And now a guy just writes you on Instagram or comes to Tenerife, signs up for the training, or to Tarifa, you know, and it's kind of there, like taking all the, soaking in all the information, you know. Do you feel like, I don't know, we had this talk with Matteo, and he said like he feels it's just way easier now, you know, for the new generation.
Yeah, I think there is two aspects. On this way, it's true that it's much easier now. Before, I was not able to sail with all the top French, like from Antoine or Cyril, or I was not able to sail with them. I had no contact with them. Like you said, I was not. You cannot write something on Instagram and, yeah, you go sailing there tomorrow, I can come, and you come, because... Before, it was not possible. The guy they were training on South Africa, on Maui, or something else. Now it's for sure. It's super easy to go to Tenerife and sail with the best guy. And on the other way, I think it's like all the windsurfing system is a little bit harder now to get the equipment, to get sponsor and everything. It's maybe a little bit harder now. For the new generation. So I don't know, but anyway, I think the level on tour, I was not in the past, but I think it's still the same, and even I would say a bit stronger. So yeah, I'm not sure it was easier or harder before or now. I don't know. Okay,
so you said like in 2013 when you almost won in Turkey, I think you finished fourth, no? You realize that you can get into the fight, and then the next year you start with a podium, and you know, you kind of, you're there, and I think you finished third. Yeah. And then comes 2015 which I think until New Caledonia you guys, like Antoine, Matteo is leading, and Antoine, or same points with Antoine, or something like this, and you are in third.
We were pretty close.
Yeah, super close anyway. Uh-huh. And then Matteo has a bit of a meltdown, and well, you win the event, and you finish same points with the world title. Describe a little bit. First of all, how does this tiebreaker work? And second of all, you know, like the feeling you get when you basically won, but you didn't.
At the moment, it was strange. I'm going to go straight for the rules because I think nobody knew the rules at this time. Especially when you see the time it took the organization to tell us who won. So the rules is it's different than an event rules. It's the one who beat the most the other in terms of event. So yeah, Antoine beat me on more event than me. So this is why he won. But it was not clear, and nobody knew at the end of the last final. Nobody knew who was the world champion. So it was pretty strange. The feeling, the what I remember it, that we finished, and I remember that I was the only. Antoine was not in the final. I was in the final, but the result was the event result for me was done before the last two races. I think I won the event before the end. So I arrived at the beach and it was nothing with the speaker. And so I went back to the container there. I start to pack my gear, but I was a little bit lost. And nobody came to us. I went one time to the office, but they say, we don't know. So I was still on my container. And I think I wait like for an hour, something like this. And then a journalist from New Caledonia came to the container and he start like, yeah, Pierre, can you come to the beach with me? We want your feeling on your second place. And then you, what? Okay, so it's done. And then at this moment, I say, okay, it's like this. And then I remember there you have like a 10, 20 minutes walks to go back to the hotel. And when I arrived at the hotel, I went crazy. I don't know why, after the shower or something like this, I went like crazy. Then I start to check all the rules. I call some friends who have much better English than me to check all the details and how it works. Then I had a call with Rich Page to be sure. Are you sure? And then for 2-3 days, I was like a little bit lost because it was the feeling of Turkey when I touch it, but 20 times stronger. I have it in the hand, but no. You fight for this and you think you have it and you don't have it for a rules. The rules is the rules, but... I was not expecting facing this situation while yeah. I was fighting for the title. It's weird. It's strange. It's strange. I respect the rules, but you fight, and I think this year was pretty intense, and we had different events. Different New Caledonia was a long one, so. Yeah, it took time a little bit to breathe and to realize. But then I think one more time I came back like stronger. For sure, it's hard to see it on the result of the year after because it was 1-2-3, 1-2-3. It was always super close. But for sure, it's a good experience. It's a hard one, but it's a good experience.
Yeah. Yeah, there is a difference between performance and result, I think.
Yeah.
And many people that watch...
Yeah, sometimes you deserve it, but you don't have it.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's the opposite.
Yeah.
You have a little bit of luck and the result is better than your performance, but it's like this. It's sport in general, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. And I think many, many people that watch don't understand this, you know, that, we could compare your New Caledonia 2015 to your New Caledonia 2020 and, you know, like the result.
Yeah.
You know, it's better in 2020, but.
Different.
Yeah, it's completely different. Okay, we talked about this thing with Craig also in a little bit more, because after 2015, North Fanatic, they had two guys in the top three, young guys that, you know, you were already top three the year before, but, you know, now you guys were really fighting for the world title. And, you know, it was clear that back then it was still not like you have Jordi, Tristan, I don't know, maybe me, whatever. Back then was like Antoine, Cyril, Micah, Bjorn, whatever, still these guys, you know, Benny, Ross, and you two young guys, you know. So then you have this situation where one company has two of you guys, and well, Matteo, he gets a big offer from Starboard. I think you get a big offer from JP. And, you know, there's kind of, again, a new situation of strategic, how to maximize, you know, your next contract, and but how to also put yourself into contention for the title, you know, because obviously the gear was good if both of you guys are fighting for the title. So maybe tell us from your perspective how it looked and how close were you to actually leaving North Fanatic?
Yeah, it was at this time it was pretty good to be two in the team, because I remember that on the shooting for the gear of 2015, something like this, we were almost 1 month together on Maui with Matteo. We were testing, we were spending time together. For sure, when you are two top guys like this sailing together, you learn a lot, and you help yourself. Yeah, you move forward. So then I remember at the end of the season, it was not easy, and we were both pretty scared about what's gonna happen with the company, because for sure, I wanted a good contract. He wanted a good contract, and. Yeah, we were a little bit scared also on how it's going to go. So I think both of us, we prepare a little bit how it can happen at the end of the year for both of us, because we were sure that it will be hard for the company to keep the two guys, but on the other way, they wanted to do it at the beginning. So yeah, and then I think I was discussing a little bit somewhere else, but I think not like Matteo, because he get a nice offer and he decide to leave. So I think anyway, if it didn't happen in 2015, it will happen in 1 year after, something like this, because it's hard for a brand to keep two top guys. So yeah, it was me. I decided to stay, and then when you realize that the other one is leaving, you think that maybe you get something better, and you are thinking, maybe I did the wrong choice. Maybe it's better there. And on the other way, you know what you have, and you don't know what you will get somewhere else. It's always like a little bit more green on your side, but you never know if it will stay green. So yeah, I prefer the security. Like you said, the equipment was good. We were going pretty good. It was me. It was my fifth year, something like this, or sixth year with the team. So you start. It's hard. It's a long process to work with people, especially when you are young. you have the language, you have to learn like the different aspects, you have to learn how to work with the designer, with the shaper. And this start to be good for my side with Fanatic and North at this time. So this was this aspect I wanted to protect it and to be sure on with who I'm working and with what kind of equipment. So
yeah. And it seems like from that point, well, from earlier even, but your careers are kind of crossing all the time, you know, you and Matteo. So maybe describe you, I don't know if you think about it that way or whatever, if you could try to describe like the differences, like the strengths and the weaknesses of one guy and the other. I know you have different styles. I remember like you, I don't remember which year it was, but you were flying on the 7.7 and he couldn't go. He was putting the 8.4 on the medium. You couldn't do it, you know, so.
Yeah, it's strange. Eh? But it's like this. I think people have some preference. I think Matteo is not more motivated than me for sure, but he's maybe more into it sometime around the mark and maybe a little bit more like smooth, depends, sometimes yes. I don't know. With the equipment, it's strange, eh? Because, but I think it's with everybody. Like,
because you are also the same size, you know,
I think we have the same size, same weight. But we don't have exact, I don't know. We don't have exactly the same style. It's not easy. It's not easy to say why this, why that. But what can I say?
So you don't analyze this shit. Okay, but, and then.
I know. The thing is, the guy, I had this question like 2 months ago about Matteo and Antoine. Yeah, can you tell me this or that on them? But the guy, they are good in every single condition. And with this gear, with that, and now, I think we managed before. He lose the title on 2015 because of, I think, some mental aspect. Me, it was the same story in Turkey. Then you learn, and you put your, like I said before, you put all the different level on top, and then you have to mix with all this all those aspects. And I think now he has all the aspects on top.
Yeah, but tell us, so when you were in Maui together for a month, same gear, same everything, who was faster in straight line?
One day he was, one day I was. Yeah, it was. Yeah, it was depending on the condition. I think it's same. I wanted to say with the 9.0, I was maybe a little bit better, but the year, the sail were flying, like in Costa Brava, it was going good. Then in Turkey, I was flying. Yeah, it was one day him, one day me. It was depending, but we were close.
Yeah. Okay, so then 2016 comes. And straight away from the start, it's you and him again. I think Antoine was a little bit out of it. I think his big board was not the best. And
I don't remember where we start, but yes, I think it was
maybe something. Maybe he also had an injury or something, but anyway, Antoine was a little bit more out of the picture, first time in about 50 years. So basically it was you versus Matteo all year. And then we get to La Torche, the final event. And basically all week there's no wind.
Yeah.
You know, like I remember you guys were doing all this media, you know, you had to do media together and you were doing crepes together and
together
whatever, you know. And then the last day comes, we were supposed to race in the morning, the wind doesn't come. And I remember till this day, like I remember you sitting in the van, like straight face, music, full power, and like again, you know, kind of another was it different, the disappointment? Like in 2015, I guess you had, you did everything you could, while in 2016 you couldn't really, you couldn't really prove it because there was no wind in the last event. And
yeah, but at the end it was harder in 2015, because in 2016 I think the final event was not running because of the wind, but then you go back to one event and it was Zilt and it destroyed the event. So it was normal, I would say. At the end, of, for me, it was easier to like in Torch when we were not racing that, he won. And I remember, like you said, the last morning of the event, it was forecast like 10 knots. Everybody was almost out of the event and we arrived together like at 7:30 or something like this, rigging trisail, preparing trisail, being on the beach for nothing. And it was until the end, it was the, even if it was almost sure that we did a race. But 15 was harder than 16, I would say.
Yeah. And then I don't know if it was after Silt or after La Torche. You said he destroyed Silt, but you gave a little interview where you said that he had some help from his team.
This point was strange also, and now it's over, definitely, from my side, from his side. But it was strange for me, and I was also younger, and I still believe that something happened, but I don't want to come back on this so much. And it was not easy. It was not on the end of the event, but it was all year long that. And at this year also, the point 17, the black sail, they were a lot of good guys. The sail were good, so they were always there. And at one moment I was believing this, so I don't know, it's the past.
But you think it helped, like you think it helps you, or the opposite? Like it's a negativity that you can put, like, okay, you know, I'm really pissed now, I'm going to perform better? Or it's like, fuck, you know, again, these guys are everywhere and blocking me.
I think it's both. Because for sure, at the beginning, at the moment, at this time, it's hard because it's hurt you, and you are younger. You don't know how to react. And the pressure is on. And then when you think about it, you learn about it and you deal with it. And so I think it was not a good thing, but it helped me at the end.
Yeah. How hard is it to keep, not that you probably try, and in sports generally it's like this, but you know, when you're fighting year after year, now probably since 2014 or 15, the three of you have been fighting against each other every event, every year, every, you know, like the relationship between you guys. I mean, it's probably pretty hard to stay neutral to the guy.
For sure. It's not easy. And I don't know what is the relationship between Federer and Nadal, for example, or Djokovic, but it's something different because it's man to man, and it's maybe easier to deal with. But the relation changed. And I would say, with Matteo, we were close when we were together. Then it went down. Then I think it come back to a normal relationship now, especially when you have a year like we have now, like we are facing now. It's easier to relax and to speak with the guy normally, and with Antoine it's a little bit different. But I think also, like, the fact that we are both French, I think there is two options when you are from the same country. you are big friends, or you are like, you are not close at all. And yeah, I think it's more going on this way. But on the other way, you like, after a year of fighting like this, there is always kind of a respect between together. And I cannot remember like a bad action or hard action between us the last 5 years on the water.
Yeah.
For sure, there were words and there were fights, but on the water, I think I never crashed into one of those two. Same for them. So yeah, the fight is at the end is pretty clean on the water, I would say.
Well, I have to say that last year when I had half a heat where I could race with you guys, I was like, holy shit, these guys are aggressive. You know, it's like in control and it's clean, yeah, like you yeah. say, but it's completely different intensity than what you have when you race for 10th place, you know? So for sure, it's bound to happen that you know, that the relationship is not the best. But I also with Antoine, I mean, I don't know, like it just seems that there is many things, no? There is this kind of South France versus North France or West France or whatever. There is the old guy that would like to be number one forever, you know, but at some point he needs to let go. There is many things. And I think it comes out sometimes like last time when you did this try them video and you had a little joke. I don't think he took it. I think he took it a little bit personally and he came up with his own video and whatever. It was fun to see, you know, there was not much to watch. And
just to come back on this, it was just the plan with the guy I did the video. It was just to give some fun to the people at this strange moment. And we had also one thing in the head with the guy. It's that when I had my title, and same for Antoine for all the title he had, it's hard in France to get some coverage from everywhere. Really, really hard. And we wanted with this video to show to some media that, because there were like big media who take the information like, and they put it straight on online that the world sailing record was break. And we wanted to show that, for a true performance, you don't speak about it. And for a shitty one, for a stupid one, you straight jump on it. And that was true. That was one of the goals, and it works. It works. And yeah, some of the journalists, they were a little bit lost facing this reality. Because when you have me, my first title, or Antoine, the 41s, you had maybe you have some local TV, you have two national newspaper, and then it's done. Even if you fight, you try. Me, when I came back from New Caledonia, I was working on it for 3 weeks with a professional girl and blah, blah, blah. And it was, yeah, but this or that, you have the handball or the football or this, the 25 division they are playing this weekend. And yeah, this was one of the plan of this project. And then to come back to the relationship, I think it's a mix of everything. Like, yeah, the guy who don't want to, who wants to continue forever. And I don't know, since the beginning, like the really beginning, I never had, I think it's the same. I can say we never had like a link together, or never be friend. And it's like this. You cannot be friend with everybody, I think. On the other way, the only thing I can you can do with a guy like this, you can just respect the all the result and all, yeah, all the windsurfing aspect. Then the rest, it's like this. You are a normal person, so you can be friend or you can, yeah. No, it's not easy. It's not easy, but I think it happened on some other sport too.
Yeah. So 17 and 18, 2017 and 2018, you guys keep fighting. Antoine comes out on top. Not going to get into those years too much. Let's talk about last year.
Yeah, we can go quick. Eh? I had some 2017. Yeah, Antoine was strong. And remember, I had the big crash in with Tati. Yes. And I think it hurt me a little bit. Not like him, for sure. I was not injured and I was lucky. But then the event after, the 6 months after this, or like the 2-3 event after this one, it was a little bit different. Because at the moment, I was not shocked of this crash. And then I think I realized more and it was harder month after month. So the end of the season was a bit strange in 17. And then 18, it's a completely different story. I just get my son, Leon, in April. And he arrived like 15 days before the start of the season. And this is maybe not the hardest event, but it changed me.
Yeah.
Like I know that I was ready for the season because I trained well in every single aspect. And then you get this in the face and wow, you are lost.
Yeah. So, do you think it's because your priorities change, or it's because you didn't sleep, or it's because you, I don't know.
From one side, like I think at the beginning, I was thinking the physical aspect was the worst. Like you don't sleep and this and that. And after like few months, I realized that it's more the mental aspect, which be shocked because it's something. It's not an event. It's not fighting for a podium. It's something else, and it's something special. So I think this changed me a little bit at the beginning of the season. And then I really have to work hard to come back where I wanted to start the season.
Yeah.
But it was for a good reason, so it's not a problem.
Yeah. Let's come back to the Tati situation. Yeah. I wanted to touch on it later, but since you mentioned it, let's do it now. So basically, for somebody, if somebody lives under a rock and didn't see this, basically there is Tati coming down from the top after a good start. And I think you were kind of in his blind spot. And he saw, or he focused on the guy below you, which I believe was Antoine. And he basically just at full speed, you guys touched, you crashed quite heavily. It was, I think, one of the scariest things I've seen in slalom. Tati got injured quite heavily. I mean, his hamstring was damaged like fully. You came out with nothing, but like you say, and I think this is really also valid for Tati, because Tati before this was, I mean, if you call me dangerous, then I don't know what you call him. Was racing really, really hard. Really, really hard. Okay, I don't want to. I said too much, but whatever. You know what I mean? He was racing really, really hard. And since then, he races very different, you know. Not that it changed him physically, but it changed him mentally for sure. And then you also expressed your feeling that it was too much, you know, that maybe this no rules is not really
something. Yeah, and on the other side, I really like the no rule system, but it was I don't know. It was the first time I saw an action like this, and I live an action like this. But at the end, it was easier to live the action than to see the action. I would say, because when I had the crash, I didn't realize what happened. Like, it was pretty strong, but in Fuerte, everything is strong. So I was not really shocked. I was more shocked when I get him in my arms, floating, like saying nothing, and he was just lying on the water. And then you say, wow, we are windsurfing, and now we are not boxing, we are windsurfing. And I was with the guy on the water till the boat, then the jet ski arrived. And it was for me the first time that something like this happened. And it was weird. It was strange. And they were, at the moment, I went out of the water, and it was, I had nothing. And I remember that like few friends, like they were almost five, some French, Marco was on the water. They were waiting me at the beach. Pierre, everything okay? Yeah, it's okay. But everybody was shocked by the action, like seeing the action. And then I remember it was not the last day of the event. So I decided to didn't check the action. And I check it on the last night after the end of the event. And at this moment, I was shocked. I was fully shocked because it was hardcore. We were on 5-2, I was, I think. And it was windy. It was super windy. And then at the beginning, I was angry against him. Then I think a little bit also, I think the organization, like the race director, he did something wrong on this day, because The race was keep going. So this is something I can accept. But then what was really wrong, it was to let me race. I remember that I finished the race because, I knew that Tati was out, so I can save 1 point. And 1 point can be something at the end of one event. So I went for the full race after this crash. And nobody was at least checking me, because all eyes were on him. And I think that was a mistake, because on the fourth mark in Fuerte, you can be, because especially this time it was offshore wind, you are pretty far, and something can happen after like this kind of car accident, I would say. So yeah, this was a little bit strange. And then for sure, the thing, You have the reality, and you have the social media, and then it went a little bit wrong on Facebook and blah blah. But yeah, I think I had to say something, because it went a little bit too far. The system is good, and I want to keep the system, but you need to respect more, and you need to, like on the road, you need to keep the control on your machine. And I think this time he was not in control. So I think there is a difference between no rules and crazy action and going for attack, but without control.
Yeah, but I think you understand that.
Yeah,
that then you are right on the edge of control to go fast. This is the biggest difference between us and amateur slalom sailors, mm-hmm. that we put the gear
on the line. Is...
You know, and then you've catapulted by yourself many times, whatever. And, you know, the fact that you lose control in the race, it can happen, just like in Formula One or in MotoGP. You know, I mean, if you see the last crash where Valentino gets the bike like mm-hmm. passed like this to his head, you know, it's like it this. Happens, no? So I guess it sucks when it happens to you, but I don't know. I think
But I remember also at this time there was also another action with Ethan, and I think it was like this action plus another one plus this, it makes all the things grow a little bit. And yeah, it's, I don't know.
Yeah, because like, you know, like you. We understand that no rules is something actually very clever, because in the end, nobody wants to crash.
You go on the water, you have rules.
If you are inside or if you have the right of way, you're going to crash just because you are in the right of way or whatever. But anyway, like these things, like with you and Tati or like with Ethan, are the first thing that gets mentioned every time somebody's against no rules, you know, that it can get dangerous, you know. But if you look at the amount of heats that went smooth and the amount of heats that something happened,
yeah,
I mean, this is probably the last time something dangerous happened, you know. And now we have these conversations with the IQ foil, with the slalom, that they want to have rules in the slalom, but you know, how you want to do it, you know. Yeah, how, you know, like,
yeah, sure. It's I think it's not possible. Yeah. Or you are not racing. We can go like time, I don't know how you say, but like the bike, you go one by one and you check the time, then you have some problem. But I cannot imagine, I don't know, cannot imagine like racing with rules, because you need to think about this. And you are just going like 30 knots, so it's 15 meters by second. How you can, how the guy from the jury can understand something, except if he's like all top 10 rider.
Yeah. And
so it's, yeah, it's hard to race with rules. You just, the only thing I have in my head is that you need to be in control. It can be hard, but and on the other way, you said the line is it's mini. I think that on this action, just to finish with this, Tati went just a little bit too crazy because he had a super start on top. But when you start on top, you have to think that there is also a guy coming from below, and they have a shorter way than you. So for sure, you're gonna find someone on your way. Except if you go 20 knots faster than the other one, but
which doesn't happen in the World Cup.
So yeah, I don't start so much on the boat, but when I start from them, I think that I will have some guy coming from below at one moment.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that's
so it's actually a good segue to what I want to talk about, because in you mentioned 17 and 18 having the kid, and 19, it seems like straight away you were actually more kind of aggressive and more, I don't know. When I think of 18 and you guys racing, I think of this one final, the last final in Fuerte, where there was like a mini gap and you just went for it. And, you say, yeah, you guys, the top three races clean my ass. It was quite hard. And then, of course, I think about the situation in the first quarter of the, you know, of New Caledonia, where you come. Yeah, I was actually in that heat. I remember from my perspective, it was like I'm in third. I look back, there is Ross and there is you. Like, I don't know, four or five boards behind. And Ross, unfortunately, he jibes many times like the old school way, where he wants to finish his jibe by the mark. So this opens up an opportunity, but actually you were a bit too far behind. And I mean, in that moment, you need to make a decision. And, you know, like whoever says that, you know, Pierre is a dick because he went straight into Ross. Like in that moment,
I almost took the decision at the mark before. I knew after the turn, not that I'm going to go for it, but I knew before that the only way I will have it's to go full from 3 to 4 and to go in. And I think for sure I went hard, but I think he did the mistake to go high and close and try to close the door. I think if he went just for a normal jibe, going a little bit with a wide hand, I never can think about it.
Yeah, like if he has the apex of his turn at the mark, you know.
And I think he knew that it's like a combination. I'm fully agree that I went pretty strong for it, and it was also really, it was special because it was the first day of the event. And from what I remember is that we get 5 general recall or 4, and 2 or 3, they were without anybody going out. I don't know if you remember this. And like all the pressure, you don't remember that Emilio...
There was something like this, but...
And yeah, it was a mix.
So what happens, I will explain the people. So what happens is that the guy on the line, he needs to call clear start or general recall. He doesn't need to call who was over early. So he calls general recall, he checks the video replay, and he realizes that he did a mistake. And I remember it happened, but I didn't remember it was this heat.
Yeah, it was this one.
Yeah.
And I think like first one, he took 1 people out. Second, no. Then 1 people out. Then on the 4th or the 3rd start, it was again nobody. And this is like, it's making the pressure growing. And yeah, I had a bad start. And when you are fighting on the semifinal with a guy like Ross, you don't have so much sense. So, yeah, I just went for it. But
it's also funny how some people, like, you go out on a semi or whatever, even if you go out on a quarter, they ask you, hey, what happened? What happened? It's like the level is so high, you know, like you need to be on it. But coming back also to Fuerte, you knew, Mateo claims that he didn't know what the points were, and you knew that. That just by passing him on that mark with that little, you know, move, that there was half a gap, you actually passed him. So that gave you the situation of New Caledonia where it's just whoever beats who wins the title. Mm-hmm. And you come in and obviously it's a lot of pressure. And to start that event with disqualification for dangerous sailing, that must have been another, not an easy moment, yeah. No,
for sure. It's you come fully motivated to attack the week, like on the best condition. I arrived there like minimum 1 week before the event. The condition were good. You are full on, and then you hit a wall. And you start from zero. I was really like starting from zero again because I start on the like the really, really first hit. I had to, in New Caledonia, it was special with the elimination. I was sailing with all the locals and yeah, it's like from top to the bottom of the bottom. And yeah, this, I'm not proud, but I'm really happy of the way I managed to, because I remember I won the elimination straight after, and I think this was also a key, because if after that you get like a 10 or a 6 or a 7, you know that you already start with some points. And yeah, being back straight with a victory was good, but on the other way, you know that the week will be long, especially there, and that you burn 1 joker and you have to work to sail well until the end, because you have no more chance.
And when you're in an event like this, how much attention you are paying to what the other guy is doing?
Less than before. I don't know. Yeah, we said before that the level is really, really, really high, and that you can go out on the even before the quarter. So at the end, it's not what Matteo is doing that will give me a result. It's more than what I'm doing. If I'm not in the qualification in top four position, I will not advance and I will not be good on the ranking. That's it, I would say. If he's in, okay, we will have to fight. If not, even if he's not in the final, I have to be in the final to result. So yeah, not so much, especially on an event like this when it's like man to man. If you focus only, because normally, except on the final, you don't meet the guy so often on the elimination. If everything goes well, depends in the other way. So yeah, at the end, I'm not checking so much.
Yeah. So you didn't see him nail the start and then slow down in the middle of the reach because of getting something on the fin, and you know, you didn't really pay attention.
Especially on the last day.
Yeah. Yeah. Then we get to the last final. And I think he needs to beat you by two places or something like this to win.
Two or three, something. Yeah. I don't know exactly the number now.
I will do some self-promotion and say that I got a good start on this one. I jibe in first, and you guys jibe. Matteo jibes in second, I think, and you jibe in third. And he.
No, I think, yeah, we were a little bit more far.
Yeah, maybe you were third and fourth.
Yeah.
But he jibes kind of into the back of the wave. He was also with 9-4, you know, it was light and whatever. And he's right there and you have a good jibe. And, you know, you flip the sail and you see him there struggling. What is your thoughts at that moment?
It was even more than this, because I remember that, I don't know what is it, but something of my sail touched his sail when we were at the mark. Yeah, it was full of pressure, this final, because like you said, on one side, I can be a little bit behind him, but not so much. So it was a little bit easier than having to be in front of the guy. But on the other way, if he win the race, and which is easily possible, I would say, and I finish four, it's done. So yeah, it was not easy. And when I saw him, like when I knew that I'm gonna jibe with him, I was like a little bit not happy, but I knew that I was close. It's not like jibing last and be having to work a lot to come back. And then when I get the planning back, I was just focused on the other mark to go as fast as possible. And then on the second mark, I was scared to have him on the inside. I didn't know where he was. And it's one of his specialty, I would say, to come back like for the sneaky inside jibe coming from below. And I was a little bit scared of this. And then I jibe, and after the jibe number two, I knew that it was just on my side, like jibing correctly, and it will be okay. But yeah, it's easier to say now than to say it on the water, especially that it was really nice, a really nice feeling, but it was special for us. That in New Caledonia, the two inside mark and the finish line, they were close to the shore. And I remember on the final, I can, not on the first mark, but then I can hear the people crying, screaming on the pier and on the rocks. Not like in the stadium, but it was, and even like on the outside mark with some boats, it was the same. And this can make you missing your job, as we are not really, yeah, in Fuerte, nobody is screaming for you. So yeah, this was special. It was nice, but it was special.
Yeah, I like it actually. Yeah, but yeah, I think people don't realize all these little things that come into it. The start, there was a big hole in the first reach. The jibes are light. The sun is low. The sun is low. So like you say, in certain angles, you cannot see anything. We have a blind spot where our mast sleeve is. So then you are sometimes not sure if the guy is there or is not there. You know, and also it's choppy, so you cannot really look around because your front foot can come out and you just catapult. So yeah, you know, a lot of things that when you're sailing a quarterfinal, you know, like me, that I had nothing to really lose or whatever, it's fine, you know. But for sure, when you have the pressure of a world title right there, all these things you start noticing them a lot more, you know.
Yeah, it was definitely not easy to say that. I remember, I don't know if it was the last day or the day before, one race I arrived first. It was close, but I arrived first at the mark, and I choose the wave, I jibe in the wave, it was everything perfect, and I fall. Why at this moment, why it was, I don't know, nothing. And it's all those small aspects, and you add on all those aspects, you add the pressure, and yeah, it's not always easy.
Yeah. Okay, so moving into this year, we were preparing for something totally new. Slalom with the foils integrated in light wind. I have to say, from all the meetings that we had on the PWA and everything, you were not, especially at the beginning, you were not the biggest fan of this idea.
No. I changed my mind a little bit, but I'm still in love of the slalom in every single condition. And on the other way, I'm getting in love of the foil now. But yeah, it's... I was scared, and it was strange also. We are like a small world, and you don't know how it's gonna happen. And at the beginning, I was not really for this change. And on the other way, especially after the, which year it was, last year, when we were sailing like foil on as one discipline and slalom in another one, we had like, even in Japan, where we didn't touch a slalom board all week long. And on the other way, we were in Costa Brava doing foil in 40 knots, which was pretty special. And we can add like a perfect 5-5 slalom day. Then I start to realize that, and at the beginning, you want both events, and then you also think about the organization part, where it's hard to provide two different events. All those aspects, they make me think about it. And at the other, on the other side, I think it's a good decision what happened,
yeah,
what we were facing now, because you are able to sail like normally 95% of the event. So it means we're gonna have like more races, more elimination, more discard, more full day during the event. Because you just race with like, I don't know, almost 5 knots less. So yeah, it's opened some new spots, some new perspective of racing. And on the other way, you keep like the essence, the base of racing. Like for me, I was a little bit scared of this when the foil arrived, is that the slalom, it starts at the beginning of winter. It's since 40 years, the slalom, it's working, I would say. It stopped during few years when the formula arrived, but thing is the base, one of the base of windsurfing, like going fast with friends. And I was a little bit scared to lose this part. And also you have all the business aspect where you don't know if you're going to get a contract or if your brand's going to go for it or no. But now I think it's pretty bad that we could not try the system, but it was the good choice. Then we have to do it and to check how it works, because for sure we're gonna have some special action and some problem sometimes, because I think you train in Tenerife mixing both discipline. We had also a training with the French team, and the guy, they are all good foiler and all good racer, like with Antoine, with Alex, with Pascal, Cédric, like some good guys. And even when you say that we go smooth, we try to don't break equipment or to don't touch, it happened that we touch, especially when you are mixing like the two discipline. It's not easy because you don't turn the same at the mark. You don't take the same, you don't have the same starting style. And yeah, so it's super interesting. And yeah, we will see how it will work.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know. I just hope that at the first mark on the first event, nobody going to die, because now it's not a fin, it's a foil. But on the other way, it's, yeah, we're going to race in zero win, and this is good.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's going to be fine. And also,
what is a little bit also like not hard from, but strange, it's that now in slalom we were coming to a tour where almost the top 25 can win a race, because everybody have the same equipment, the same fin, almost the same equipment. And now there is for sure some difference because the foil, we are at the really beginning of the foil, and you need to work. It's a lot of work to understand everything and to have the good one. But so this will change a little bit. It will make the mechanic aspect coming back a little bit more, but yeah, we will see. And the other way,
for a time. But you know what was amazing? Everybody was asking, like, in Croatia, you know, how was the foiling? How was the foiling? How was the foiling? I'm like, you know, in the end, it's slalom. It's a start. It's four jibes. It's man-to-man racing. Like you know, you are close. You are you're fighting. You are. So in the end, it's like, now I don't even see it as two different things, you know?
But I think I'm agree with you on the point that when we're going to do just, when you, we're going to be just foiler or just slalomer on the water, it's going to be the same. But when we're going to mix, it's going to be, because I think in Croatia, you didn't mix, no?
We didn't mix, no. In Tenerife, we mixed, yeah.
Something new. Because you have the guy coming from there, or going for, you are fighting with a foiler and the guy go like 20 meters down to get the speed. Then you come back at the mark, like pointing like nothing else. And yeah, this is going to be new.
And what
from the last past year, it's that you really have to fight. You are all, we were almost all the same speed. Now, if one brand come with some, and if they come with like the magical foil, it's because they work for it, so it's good. But and you cannot fight, you cannot have like the true fight, this, we're gonna lose this part a little bit. But like you said,
yeah, but you know, you see already now, like it's already, I don't know, four brands that are competitive, you know. And if somebody comes with something amazing in slalom, some new carpenter fin or, you know, whatever, it's the same. C'est la vie, no?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So this year, so you're preparing. Some guy eats a bat in China and we have this amazing situation. So what have you been up to except daddy stuff?
Like you said, I was really working on it. Like I spent 3 weeks home in December. Then I flew to Tenerife on the 2nd of January. So yeah, I was motivated for it. I spent 1 month in Tenerife. Then I was lucky to go in Japan for the Defi Win, the event. It was good to have an event before all this situation. And then I went back to Tarifa for almost 3 weeks. And then I come back home like something like 10 days maximum before the lockdown. And Marco Lang came to my place, and like from the day after my drive from Tarifa, he was there in front of my house. Pierre, we go, we have to finish testing. Yeah, we go. So we were like on. I was counting the day before the event. I was checking all the different aspects, if everything was good, and I was super motivated. And then I remember it started one night. We were eating in front of the TV, and the French president starts speaking. And yeah, he was starting to say, because before, I don't know how it was where you were, but before it was not so much. When I was in Japan, we were laughing about the Chinese people and all this stuff that it's in China and blah blah blah. Same for when I was in Tarifa, it was nothing special. And then you come back, and yeah, the next morning I tell Marco, I think you should go home before they close everything. And he just take a shower, pack his stuff, and he was driving full speed to arrive in Austria on time. And I think the next morning it was the life stop. And in France, it was pretty strong, and they really went like the president, he announced like a war on the TV. So yeah, it was from full preparation to zero, we stop. And I knew that my girlfriend was working and she cannot stop, so they closed the kindergarten, so I knew that I'm going to be the true papa. And it was the same story, like on the side of sport, it came from 100% to zero, and the papa side, it went the opposite. It was from zero to full time, and that was not easy. At the beginning, like the first 2 weeks, I was a little bit scared of the virus and of everything. So I went not so much out of the garden, and I went 2 times in my street, but like really, really scared, I would say. And then, I start to organize my life a bit differently. We were playing together with my son, and I would say the life was around him, and it was the first time for me and for him. So it was nice. It was was learning. It was the beginning of the situation was okay. Then it started to be a little bit different, like beginning of April or middle of April, because like the situation was still growing, and it was everybody was lost, I would say. And it started with the industry. I had some call from the sponsor, and they announced that they're going to reduce the the budget and the salary for the year because of this, because of that. And at the beginning, you understand it. I was agree with them, and I was ready to, like, not to fight a war, but that it takes maybe 6 more months. And I was not missing so much windsurfing, I would say. I was doing my workout home on the garage. It was not so funny, but the water part, it was okay, because I had plenty of stuff to do. I had to play with my kid. I had to work on in my house, in my garage. It was time to clean the garage, to work on some equipment. It was the first time since 5 years that I have time for me, time for home, time for to do something else. So it was okay. And
for Grappin?
Yeah, no, I think this is a little bit too old now. We have to come back with if we have a second lockdown, I will come back with it best. No, and then it was hard because they announced the 11th of May as the new start. And then it took like 10 more days before they opened the beach again. They opened the beach, the harbor, and like the water. Because at one moment it was strange because the water was open, but the beach and the harbor were closed. So it was not possible to sail. And this make everything like the last 10 days were pretty strange. And then when we were when we came out of this, I was fully motivated again. I start my workout plan the same as before, except the fact that at the gym where I'm going, you had to do this, you had to do the test, you had to do plenty of stuff with the doctor and everything to show that that you are in good shape, and even if you get the virus, you can survive and you can have no problem. So that was a little bit special. And we start even to go at the gym at the beginning with the mask, but then it stopped quickly because it was not really possible, I would say.
Yeah.
Then I would say May, June, July, even if the event were canceled, it was almost back to normal life. I was sailing, I was trying to be fit again because I lost a lot, and I was not expecting to lose so much during this time. And then I decided to go to Switzerland for the foil, and I was there. I was really, really happy to compete. But in my head, it was always like Marignane, if the event will happen in October, because it's going to be a hard event with a new discipline, everything in one event. So I have always this in my head. And when they called the event, when they canceled the event, I went a little bit crazy. I fully understand the situation, but it was strange.
Yeah, it was shit, no? Because we live for this. You can say Silva Plana, exactly. You can say Defu in Japan, whatever. But in the end, it's like a big hole in the,
for sure.
The thing. For the people that are listening and not watching, when Pierre mentioned Silva Plana, I gave him the finger because we raced for, I don't know, 4 days or whatever. We did, I don't know how many races. And then he finished third, same points with me, but I finished fourth. So so thanks. Thank you. And actually, then somebody told me, I didn't watch, that you passed Mateus on the last reach to the
thing. Wow. I didn't know the number, but I knew that I was a little bit too far, so I had to push. So I push, but it was for me, it was super nice to come back to on racing mode, even if it's a different event and a different discipline. I was not expecting this. To be so happy to be back on the starting line.
Yeah.
Place is so really, really nice. But I was just happy to race.
Yeah, it's funny. I know you feel a little bit the same. I'm not the biggest fan of course racing. I think it's a little bit like, you know, too much chess and not enough action, but whatever. But actually, you know, when you prepare for an event and you put your mind into it, it doesn't really matter what you're competing in.
It was
in.
Good to be back on this mode.
Yeah.
I know I went to train in Brittany like before the event, and it was back in the normal life. We were in the road, even if I'm not the biggest fan of driving 15 hours, but the normal life start again.
It was
good.
Yeah. Do you ever think, I mean, you're what now, 31? Do you ever think what comes after the career? I mean, you can still do it for 10 years if you want to, but, or more, 15.
The thing is, before to be professional, I said it before, my parents, they were always pushing me to go for studies, and I went to school after like what we call the BAC in France. And I had my master degree, and then I decided to start with windsurfing, like to let me 2-3 years to see if I can be professional and if I can live from this. And from this moment when I saw that I can, as I was on the podium, and I can live from this, and I can call it my job, I decide to don't think so much about the future and the after. And on the other way, this year with my sister, we opened like a little surf school. And it's like just, it's not, I don't want to do this. I'm not sure that I want to do this for the future, for example, but it can be an option. And we start working on this. And on the other way, I don't know if I would like, for example, to work on the industry, or if I would like to go on something else. At the moment, I just want to focus. Like during the lockdown, I was thinking, I think if I can go for 10 more years, and if I'm still like passionate by what I'm doing, I will continue for a minimum 10 years. Because this is my feeling at the moment. Because I faced the different option, like being no time home and being full time home, and I think it will be super hard to be always at home and to work in a normal company with like from Monday to Friday and with some holidays, and this will be super. I don't know if it will be possible.
Scary, no?
Yeah. So this, I prefer to wait for it.
Yeah, for sure. So what's your master degree in what field?
It was a business school, and I was the last year I was working on small company, how it works and
management, like small company management.
But small company. That's because good. I knew that, I don't know, but it's not on my plan to work for a big, big company. And now I'm running like kind of a small company, and it helped me a little bit at the beginning. So
for sure. Yeah. For sure.
Because I don't know how is it for you, but I have my small company, and you have to make the accountancy and all this.
Yeah, definitely. It is a lot more than I thought it would be. You know, to get to all the do all the taxes and all the paperwork and all the, you know, and whatever. And but it's okay. Yeah.
Thinking about all the insurance. Yeah, but it's okay.
Yeah. Okay, we have this section at the end that we ask everybody. There were supposed to be quick fire questions, but I think they are a bit slow. So let's call them slow fire from now. What are your pet peeves? Is the first one.
Pet peeves. What's the peeves?
Pet peeves is like it's like something that really annoys you, like really, I don't know, that you hate it, like I don't know, like I would say it's the dentist, you know, for me, I don't know, something. Yeah. Like
the checking at the airport, the not the dentist, the girl in front of me.
You don't like to sweat a little bit before you get on a 12-hour plane?
It's really one of the part of the job I don't like. But I think it's the same for a lot of guys. I prefer to go to the dentist.
You know, last time I went to Mallorca without the gear for fun, I was still stressed at the check-in. And then I realized, fuck, actually, I don't have the gear. Why am I stressed?
So. Yeah, when we discuss with guy like some business guy who are travel a lot, I'm tired of that. Hey man, me, I travel with those 200 kilo of shit, and I'm not in business class, and it's a little bit different.
Yeah, exactly. Big guys, a lot of big guys in economy class, let's say, when we travel for events.
You really expect to don't be sit close to another rider because it means you have no spot, no place.
And also after checking into 100 kilos of gear, you smell not so great. So this is also another situation. Three apps you can't live without.
The Facebook. Or the, now it's more Instagram, I would say.
Yeah.
WhatsApp. And windy.
There you go. How many times a day you pee your wetsuit?
Oof. A lot. Depends. I don't care.
Yeah. You can buy your, you sell your used wetsuits afterwards?
Depends. Depends.
What is your guilty pleasure?
A glass of red wine.
Really French. Some cheese as well.
Yeah, a little bit. But the red wine is not bad. The wine in general is not bad in France.
Yeah. Your top five windsurfers of all time.
I would say Bjorn, Richard, Kevin, because I really like the fact the guy is, he was a machine in racing, in slalom, and he's ripping no keeper. And he's also a really nice guy. Then top five, so three more. Golito. Because I think he put the sport in a different way. Because he was one, he's the only like old freestyler mixing with the new generation. He's the oldest, I would say, now, and he's just crazy. And then I would like to put a wave sailor, but there is plenty of really really good guy that I like to see. Guy like Thomas, for example, I really like the spirit of the guy and his level. And it's crazy to think that the guy is coming from south of France where the wave are not, it's not Maui or it's not Brittany. And the guy is one of the best in the biggest wave
in
the world. And last one, it's hard to say, but for sure the Antoine is one of the best windsurfer ever. So yeah, I had him.
Okay. So it's a pretty solid top five.
Yeah, I think we have a sport where there is like there is some incredible athlete, and the fact there is different discipline, it's also good that that windsurfing permits you to do so much stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
From style to now foil and going in 10 meter wave, going 40 knots or 50 knots.
Yeah, and it's all fun, no? Like,
yeah.
I cannot do freestyle at all, but when I have a session, it's fucking fun, you know? So
yeah, sure. And always when you have like some, you go for your slalom training and there is like 50 cm of wave and you go with your 4.7, you enjoy it. And yeah, every single aspect of the sport is good. So this is cool.
Yeah, for sure. Your most underrated windsurfer of all time.
Of all time, yeah, the old generation, I don't know so much, but
not old time, like
from all time. But so I mean, I'm gonna speak about the new generation because the old one, I don't know so much, but I would say from now, and it's a guy I'm spending a lot of time with him. It's Pascal Tuzeli, because he has some incredible talent and he's a really, really good windsurfer, and he miss not so much to be on top.
Yeah. He's quite fast, I would say.
He's one of the fastest.
For sure. For sure. Foil freestyle, yes or no?
Like 2 years ago, I could say no. And now, especially after seeing what they are starting to do, I would say yes. And it's the same way as us. It's not the base of the sport, but it helps to sail everywhere, every day. And I know it's hard for the guy because it's different, but it was different for us also. And they make windsurfing cool in 10 knots, so exactly. Why not?
Exactly. Obstacles in slalom. We put a sausage in Fuerte once in a while.
Yes. But when it's windy, but yes.
Yeah. Beach starts. Yes or no?
I don't know. Joker. It's not easy because the normal start, it's not easy. But the beach start, it's, I don't know, I'm not trained to it. And yeah. It can be, maybe less fair. But maybe if we do it for 10 days, I will say it's fair. I don't know.
Yeah. One spot you have to sail every day for the rest of your life. What do you choose?
Okipa, it's not bad, but in South Africa, in Cape Point, I had some incredible session. So I would say this to say something different also. And
so you live with the baboons.
I really enjoy my time there. So I would say South Africa.
Yeah. Worst excess baggage bill or your worst check-in story?
The bill, it was 2,500. So it's
and the story behind the bill.
Yeah, but that time it was, I think it was no story because it was you pay or you don't pay or you don't go. Yeah. But crazy story. There is plenty. Yeah. There is like, I think 2 years ago or 3 years ago in Korea when we were like almost 50 or 70 guys. And at the middle of the checking, they changed the rules.
Yeah.
So So that was, and I think I was one of the last one with the good rules, because yeah, it was something like you pay for one equipment is 3 bags or 4 bags, then they switch to one equipment is 1 bag. But that was it was a mess.
Yeah.
And then this year I had a nice story in Japan when we went for the defi, because we arrived somewhere in the airport of Tokyo and we had to change terminal. We were like 10 and we had to stop a bus. We put all the stuff of everybody in one bus, and the Japanese, they were fully scared because normally they respect the rules, and we were not really respecting the rules of the bus. And it was funny because in this kind of place they are really strict, and you come with something different. But there is plenty of story. There is a story where you arrive at the counter and you are a little bit too tired from the party of the night before, and you have some trouble to deal with the girl. You have a place where it's super hard. The guy arrived and he tell you that you have to pay €40 for 12 bags. Okay. So there is million of different stories.
And then you get even more stressed because you're like, I need to, before they realize that they made a mistake, I need to pay and check in. And so then you start running even more.
Yeah, there is plenty of story.
Who is your worst competitor in your heat? Like, not even, not even for a contest or for a season, like who you hate having in your heat?
In your heat. It's not easy. There is plenty of bad guy. there is plenty of fast guy. I don't know. There is too many.
I think 5 years ago you would say something different, but. But it's okay. Who was your worst roommate at an event?
Tristan, because he's making some noise when he's sleeping.
You get $1 million in cash and you need to spend it in 24 hours. What do you buy?
1 million only. Yeah. I wanted to sell a plane, but it's going to be hard.
Yeah. With 1 million, it's hard.
I don't know. A nice house on the beach, somewhere on the beach.
You can buy it for $1 million, €1 million?
Depends.
Not really. Huh?
Maybe so. In the middle of nowhere.
Yeah. Okay, last
but 1 million, it's not enough.
Yeah, that's why it's a question. It's not, know, 1 billion, because everybody knows there, no? But
no, it's a good one.
And last but not least, who would you like to hear on the podcast?
I loved when you did like Anders also, because it helps, and Josh, because it helps to learn more from the past and from the good years. Maybe Robert Territeo. I think it's going to be impossible. But
why?
Because it's impossible to know where is this guy. And I met him like the first year in New Caledonia, and it's a super, 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 super nice guy. Yeah. But he gave me his phone, and when you come to Maui, you tell me that it was impossible to know where he was. Then he called me, but even if he didn't have my number, he managed to find a way with And yeah, it's, and I think he has some crazy, crazy story.
Yeah, not sure if he wants to share all of them, but
yeah, but he was a rock star.
For sure. For sure. Okay. Thank you so much. I let you go back to daddy duties.
No. It's okay. Now I'm gonna go in the water this afternoon.
Perfect. Yeah, I see you around, I guess. Tenerife or somewhere.
You my check and yeah, hope to see you somewhere soon.
Yeah.
Okay. For racing.
Hopefully. Hopefully. Missing it. Okay. I see you. Thanks for taking my spot in Silva Plana again.
No problem.
Anytime.
We had to fight. It was a fight between France and Poland.
Yeah.
It was a good fight.
In the end, fucking France always wins, but it's like the Germans in football.
No. Hey, who won the last World Cup?
I cannot remember.
Okay.
Croatia was in the final.
Yeah, but you are Polish, eh?
Yeah, I know. Okay, cheers, man. I appreciate it. Mate. Bye.
Thanks a lot for listening. Hope you enjoyed that podcast with the current world slalom champion. I wonder what's going to go on with the tour in 2021. Hopefully, we are back to business and we can see those boys and girls racing at the highest level. If you like the podcast, don't forget to subscribe to the channel so you don't miss one. And if you really like them and you want to see them keep them coming, maybe you can chip in a bit of beer money, support the channel, and we can keep bringing you all the news and action and obviously future podcasts. I'll put the link below. I'll also put some links to other podcasts up there because we've had some beauties so far. The Robbie Nash one obviously going down really well. And obviously a thumbs up like if you liked it.